It's a Game Centre podcast. My name's Michael Cooper.
I'm Keaton Gillian. How's it going?
And I'm Batman. How you doing?
I wasn't expecting that. Right, we've got an opening question. Batman. It's from Jennifer Richardson. Would you rather be sticky or itchy for the rest of your life?
Neither.
You can't have neither.
No, you've got to sit in the fence on this one. It's got to be one or the other.
Okay, well.
But weigh up the pros and cons on that one. It's like, sticky, you're kind of going to bed and you're just like lying there.
Oh, that'd be awful.
No happening.
Mm-hmm. Well, I was like, doing anything. Like, imagine performing a mundane task. Like, imagine trying to cook a cake and then try to pour out the flour. And then you put your hand in the flour. Then you've got flour all over your hand for the rest of the week.
You wouldn't do well in British Bake Off then, would you?
You couldn't lie on the floor.
You couldn't cook, you couldn't hoover, you couldn't clean, you couldn't...
That could be a good thing, though.
Well, you could.
You couldn't
really
peel stickers
well
off games.
Yeah, you wouldn't need a hoover, just roll about the floor for 20 minutes. The thing is, we're saying that, but I'd probably rather be sticky. There's nothing worse than being itchy. The other week, about 2 days ago, I had a itch right in the middle of my back, and it was that point you couldn't reach.
Right,
and
okay.
I'm like Goro, flopping about.
My argument for Team Itchy, hashtag Itchy, is that basically you get used to being itchy after a certain amount of time.
But see, if you're scratching and you're scratching, then you're like, you almost break the skin, and
there's skin left.
No happening.
Well,
that's worse. I think that's worse. That has to be worse than being sticky.
I think so.
Because if you think about it, right, see if you scratch all your skin off, and then you're just like this bloodied mess. You're going to be sticky anyway.
Well, exactly.
You're going to bleed out, and then that takes you to a whole other level, isn't it?
Yeah.
So itchy leads to death, and sticky leads to an awkward,
sticky
everything.
Mess.
Yeah. We've all been there. First thing we want to talk about this week is Quantum Break. I don't know if you guys have saw it before we actually get into the mechanics of the game. On Twitter, it looks very cool. I always worry when you do time travel-y stuff because it's one of the hardest things to get
yeah,
right.
I,
you know,
I just sort of convey in a game.
But on Twitter, Xbox UK, we'll tweet the link out. What they did a thing where what you did was you went to the top pinned tweet, and you went into it, and it showed you a little video, and at the end. You're walking along the platform, and you can either inspect the area, or you can go down a ladder, and you retweet, reply to them, descend or inspect, and that leads you to another video. Remember those like adventure books?
Oh yeah,
like,
yeah.
Go to page 8,
and then if you went to like page 23, like the crocodile would eat you, so you'd have to like you'd quickly skip back and go. No, I never meant to go that way.
Finger was on a page. Yeah. So it doesn't count.
Doesn't count.
So it was one of them. I did it, and it was very interesting. And it was very good because it showed you all the aspects of the game. All the mechanics you'd want to know about, and if you've got a chance, I'd recommend you to do it.
That's
yeah,
cool.
for being an Xbox exclusive, obviously, or the Sony guys miss out on this one, which is quite sad because for a new IP, and as you said, obviously being time travel, everyone's kind of wondering, oh, how's it going to convey the message and stuff, but it's done particularly well. From the guys that brought you Alan Wake,
mm-hmm.
So you know you're getting a good. Story-driven based game there, and that's exactly what it is. It's incredibly story-driven.
Yeah, like you can kind of like I assumed that from the kind of lineup of actors that they've got. Like you got Lance Reddick in there, who's Zavala from Destiny, and he's also in Fringe. And you have Aidan Gillen, who is obviously Littlefinger. You have Sean Ashmore, who was Iceman in the X-Men films, and you have that other person.
That other person.
You know what I mean?
The guy from The Following, the main guy.
Yes.
Mike from The Following.
Right, okay, cool.
Yeah, sorry.
The other guy was in Lost as well.
Who was in Lost?
I can't remember his name now. No, totally gone. Totally gone.
You said about Alan Wake, you get that with it, don't you?
Yeah, you get that with it as well. So total downloadable code for the full game.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So you're getting your two games in one, which is really good because Alan Wake's a good game in itself, good
very
standalone.
Good,
so,
very good.
But the IGN review for the guys obviously kind of follow IGN and stuff gave it a solid 8 out of 10, which I was quite impressed with, to be fair.
Mm-hmm. Really good.
So no, it's good. It's getting backed up by a TV show as well, which is pretty cool. Because how you play the game shapes obviously. The personalised version of the TV show, so it should pan out.
Is it a TV show as well? Because I was sure it was like the cutscenes in it between chapters, I'm sure are like 20 minute like television episode-esque videos.
Yeah.
But has it got a TV show as well?
Yes, yeah, so it should be relating to the TV show. Okay. I think the whole point of, like, if you remember Defiance and things like that, you were obviously only meant to... I think they wanted to strategize the game where you played it up to this certain point, and then come the Monday night, the TV show would play, which would give you, like, the next chapter, and then the next part of the game would follow one from the TV show type
idea.
That's
a pretty interesting way to do it.
And it's just on PS... sorry, it's not on PS4. is it just on Xbox or is it PC as well?
PC. Xbox and PC.
PC as well. But Kieran, you've got some news on the and the good PC availability on the game, because they've done something pretty sweet with the PC version, haven't they? Through your gameplay.
Alright, yeah. If you pirate the PC version of Quantum Break, the main character actually comes with an eye patch equipped. I thought that was pretty funny.
It's pretty cool considering how we've been shooting about pirates for about the past 3 weeks like that.
Waiting for a pirate game.
Yeah, waiting for a pirate game.
As close as we're going to get.
Now you just get an eye patch, and then everyone will hate you because you'll know that you've pirated the game or obtained the game through.
Yo, imagine that
means.
Time traveling pirate with time manipulation pills and guns.
Yeah,
it's cooler.
Exactly.
But no, a good overall solid game. I need to get into it more. However, I'm off on holiday and stuff this week, so. Maybe I'll try and find some time and get proper into it, because as I said, it's proper story driven. So if you've only got that half hour or an hour to pick up the game, then I'd maybe advise trying to spend a little bit more time on it.
Yeah, it's one of these games where I don't want to say gap filler, because I think that saying that's a disservice. I mean, it got 8 out of 10. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. But I think if it was on both consoles, it would have been huge.
Yeah, I always kind of thought that. Like, I thought the thing that turned me away from it is exclusivity. Like, that always puts me off. Like, I'm always a bit like, you shouldn't really be punished for picking one platform over another. And
it's kind of sucky how they do that.
But I mean, Tomb Raider. I mean, you know what I mean. Everyone was raving about that, and I think this one's a very solid game in itself. Mm-hmm. It's just if had a lot of these games as well. It's what they come out near. Affects it as well.
Yeah.
Because no one's buying Quantum Break because of what's coming on Tuesday, Dark Souls, of course.
Yeah, exactly.
So I think it's it could be
what's
part
coming
of
either before or after it, because it has an impact. And I think that's had a big impact on Dirt Rally as well.
Yeah,
although obviously
it launched the same day as Quantum Break, didn't it?
Came out on the Tuesday as well.
Yeah.
However, like, how surprising that game's been is like a proper phenomenon. Really, I got like an incredible 8.9 out of 10.
Yeah, I was reading through Metacritic the other day, and it just sounds absolutely amazing. It's a really good kind of start of the year for the kind of racing genre.
Yeah, for the rally genre.
We've not had anything so far, and of course we've got like a set of Corsa coming out later on, and it sounds absolutely phenomenal.
Yeah.
Like, I don't play racing games, I don't particularly like them or anything, but if you're into the racing games, then it sounds like one that you're definitely going to want to pick up.
Yeah,
I mean, it's not my thing, it's nothing I've played, but everything I've seen about it, you've got to. It doesn't hold your hand much. It kind of, you've got to. It throws you into it, and it rewards you for being brave in it. Your co-driver actually tells you one stage to be brave, and I think if any game tells you that, I think.
What was that?
Make sure you've got your seatbelt on.
Yes, pretty much.
Be brave. Was that Halo Reach's tagline?
Be brave. Don't know. Should ask Jason on that one.
No, it was Destiny's. It was Destiny's.
Destiny's.
I'm sure it was Destiny as well.
There you go.
It's a good shout though. Good shout. But no, definitely, like, I didn't know what to expect from Dirt Rally. Obviously, bringing you like the other previous Dirt games and Colin McRae and stuff like that.
Yep.
I know they're always built on solid foundations and stuff. But no, the definitely one to pick up, guys. If you're a racing fan out there, as I said, like, we're not too into a racing game. We probably should be, though. To be fair, we probably should be picking these up just to give a wee bit more info, other than obviously what we've seen in trailers and what we've maybe had hands on in stores.
Mm-hmm.
But no, like, total solid driving game and certainly one to pick up.
If you've been playing it as well, let us know what you think as well. Because I mean, sometimes it's just our opinions. I mean, that's
it's cool to get some feedback from the guys
exactly,
that listen and stuff.
Exactly.
Speaking of games that don't hold your hand much.
Yeah, that's the next big one, isn't it?
Yes.
Tuesday's
be brave,
coming.
Kieran. Be brave, Kieran.
Dark Souls 3 coming out on Tuesday, and honestly, I'm so excited. I just spent the last 2 days in my friend's flat. Dark Souls 1 came out on the Xbox One backwards compatibility the other day, so we sat and just blitzed it over the last couple of days, and it was so phenomenal. Like, see, even playing the first one, and it's like I don't even know how many years old it is now, but it's about the same age as my sister. And it's honestly, it's still absolutely amazing to sit down and play that kind of game that doesn't tell you what to do. It doesn't like treat you like you're an idiot.
Yeah.
It expects that you know kind of what you're doing. It's got a very, very steep learning curve to it, and I'm looking forward to the third one with all the kind of updated visuals and whatnot, and just from what I've seen, the very little that I've allowed myself to watch, it looks absolutely phenomenal. And I saw there were a bunch of review scores and things that were out,
yeah.
And they're very, very promising. Like I think it was like a 94 out of 100 I saw Polygon gave it a 7 out of 10 based on frame rate issues, but to be honest, all of From Software's games have had kind of frame rate issues.
Yeah, they've all kind of went down that same bit, so you kind of tend to expect that a wee bit.
That's
really
kind of where they fall off. But
yeah.
Aye, if you're not too bothered by the frame rate or that, I don't think it's to be too kind of severe. Like, I know Bloodborne in some areas and Dark Souls 1, the drop off is really bad. I don't expect it will be anywhere close to that. Yeah. I think the game will be absolutely phenomenal.
Again, still got time to fix that as well, though. Do you know what I mean?
Aye, exactly. There's still time for like the kind of patches and whatnot to roll out, and we see more and more often that games will come out in one state and then a year later they'll be completely different.
Completely different.
Even if we look at like Assassin's Creed Unity, like I came out and it was a mess. Yeah. Now it's not perfect, but it runs okay.
Same as Drive Club and that as well.
Mm-hmm, exactly. Yeah.
But you've kind of steered away yourself from all the trailers and all the sort of sneak peeks and stuff. You've sort of kept yourself blind to the whole thing.
Yeah. Like you find this with a lot of the kind of Dark Souls fans and whatnot. You tend to not watch anything at all, just because it's so. Oftentimes you'll see bosses and whatnot revealed online, and it's just it ruins the experience a bit, because part of the kind of thrill of it is going through, like there's always fog before the bosses, and part of the thrill is going through that and not knowing what to expect and being a bit like because you're kind of taken aback, and there's like a kind of sense of wonder there, because you're like, how the hell am I meant to fight this thing?
Well, all the bosses in this one are demonic sheep, just letting you know.
Witcher 3 style.
Yeah, no, not really. I'm just kidding.
We'll tweet out, I don't know if you guys, so we did see it last week, it was you, Kieran, showing me the Eli Roth trailer, the Witches.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
Yeah, that's very good.
Eli Roth did like an animated short film.
Back from the 80s, wasn't it?
No, that one.
This
was an Eli Roth animated film that he did, and it's two minutes long.
I've seen that one, yeah.
And it's kind of messed up, but it's a Dark Souls trailer, but it's kind of very loosely around Dark Souls. I think he was just kind of given a topic and told me.
It's
really cool, though.
It's very Eli Rothy, then.
It's pretty messed up if you're watching it. But as you say, there was also the 80s trailer, which is really cool again.
Yeah, I thought the 80s trailer was particularly cool. I think we shared that on our main Game Centers page.
We did.
But we can obviously tweet up the link and stuff like that as well and have a wee recap on that, because that was pretty sweet, actually. Quite enjoyed that one.
I don't think they do that anywhere near enough, because, I mean, there's a lot of games out there that could not. You'd like to see if they were going to do an 80s trailer for any game, I probably wouldn't have picked
Dark Souls. Yeah, I know. Yeah. But it's like the whole thing, like people go crazy for it, like Blood Dragon for Far Cry. Remember when that got announced?
Yeah.
Everybody went mental.
Aye.
Yeah.
But again, that could be just a generation thing, though, isn't it, really?
Yeah. Back to your childhood in a way. Like we were talking about California Games last week. And stuff like that. It captures what people remember. Actually, the other day, just in the head office, I saw a Back to the Future Master System game.
Oh,
it was
really?
Back to the Future 2 for the Master System. And on the box, on the back of the box, it said containing 5 levels. I was like, I don't remember the point where games didn't tell you. We've only got.
But do you remember, like, see out of those 5 levels, I'll guarantee you probably about 3 people in the world have completed that game, because you couldn't save the thing. So you had to leave your console on for like 4 days straight in order to complete the game.
The worst one was International Superstar Soccer for the SNES. And if you wanted to save, what it did was give you a load of characters, like Asterix, Full Stop, I'm trying to think, the ampersand. And it was just all these characters. And there's probably, you're probably talking about 30. I'll scour the internet and I'll find a photo. And what you had to do is you had to write it all down. And the next time you wanted to play in that tournament, for example, you have to. So it was obviously code, essentially.
Yeah, so it was like a passcode. Yeah, you had
essentially.
To enter. Yeah.
And there was no saving it, but it was just basically if you put these in the right order, you would get like Italy in the semi final against Brazil, that type of thing. And it was just an absolute nightmare. There was no conceivable way that you'd get them all right. Like I said, there's probably about 30.
Make you feel grateful for how things are today.
Yeah, exactly.
Just taking a picture on your camera phone. You know
exactly. I autosave. As much as I don't trust it. I never trust autosave.
You still do the whole thing where you get the autosave and then you go, I'll just save it under a different file just in case.
Yeah, I'm terrible. Like I I was playing Pokemon on my 3DS the other night, and I was like, right, cool. Autosave's a thing. This is 2016. It'll be fine. Nah, you still need to go on and save it. I should have known that, like, having, like, collectively across all the Pokemon games, like, thousands and thousands and thousands of hours played. Mm-hmm. I should have known that. But I don't know. I just...
Never trust autosave. I don't know why as well, because, I mean, it does kind of what it wants. I've never had a situation where autosave hasn't worked.
Well, do you leave the house, right? See, when you leave the house, you lock the door, and then do you try the handle to see if it's definitely locked? That's why autosave, you don't think it works.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, see?
That's true.
See, principle's exactly the same.
Yeah. I kind of forgot how we got onto this. Lincoln from Dark Souls. From Dark Souls, we have a competition. Dark Souls competition. Woo-hoo. Giveaway stuff. Well, I'm not too sure if you know, but we've recently jumped onto Twitter. We're called the GCPC. Oh, at my goodness. At the GCPC. Follow us on there. And if you give... When this podcast comes out, we're going to be tweeting the link on the...
Sorry. Kieran's dying. Yes.
We're going to be tweeting the link on Twitter. So follow us on Twitter, give that link a retweet, and three random folk will win a Dark Souls comic that you can only get if you purchase the game, is that correct?
Yeah, mm-hmm. If you pre-ordered a copy of the game.
So, no, I'm just thinking how tragic it would be if I died before I played Dark Souls 3. But I...
Yes. Especially on the podcast. We'd finish it. I'm not. You know what I mean?
Yeah, we would finish it.
Yeah, exactly.
Boy's death goes viral on podcasts.
Exactly. It's 16 minutes when I'm not getting back. I'm not starting again.
Think of the clickbait title we could have now.
Yeah, that's true.
The sad thing is that would probably get the most amount of views and stuff.
It would, I like a snuff podcast.
Let's
boy coughs on stream. You won't believe what happens next.
Yeah. Tweet us, does he live or does he die?
We could do the whole Microsoft interaction thing.
Well, there you go.
You'll have to wait till the end to find out what happened.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, Dark Souls 3 comics to give away, and we've also got a
Dirt Rally t-shirt as well.
Yeah.
I love these t-shirts. See, we get these t-shirts in the stores every now and then, and they're having their great.
Yeah, I'm not thinking about it.
Got a pretty cool Quantum Break one the other day too, so I did.
Yeah. Where'd you get that from? Tapping his nose, that's good radio.
He has his sources.
Yes, exactly. That's cool. So, once again, the Dirt Rally t-shirt, that's a like and share on Facebook as well. So, so you got loads of stuff away. We gave away codes,
Doom beta codes
last week, and we're giving away stuff.
Let us know, obviously, the people that won the Doom beta codes, obviously, how he's enjoyed the beta and stuff like that as well. That'd be good, interesting feedback.
There was actually a guy on Facebook got back to us, off the basis of the Doom beta, he tried because of it. He sent me a picture of his receipt going into Hamilton. A fellow, I believe his name is Gary Lee.
Cool.
And he purchased it. Well, he put a pre-order on the basis of winning a free. The system works, doesn't it?
Yeah.
You know. So
Bazinga.
Exactly. I think he purchased it on the Xbox. Speaking of the Xbox, bit of a segue, quite smooth, if I do say so myself.
Yeah, we planted Link in there, yeah.
Yes.
Some announcements this week.
Yeah.
Some pretty big announcements as far as Xbox is concerned.
Just looking at the way you've taken this out with multiplayer beta for Gears of War 4.
Yeah, thanks, Kieran. Yeah. you can type up the notes next week. Gears of War 4 announcement from just a couple of days ago, actually. Announced for a release date for the 11th of October, so it's not even that far away.
No, I was going to say, yeah.
I was expecting it at some point a wee bit, maybe November-ish, but 11th of October for that one, so that's definitely one to mark in the calendar. Mm-hmm. They've actually confirmed that it's going to contain split-screen. That's split-screen that no other game seems to do anymore.
Speaking about time travel.
So you're going to have split-screen in all game modes, but sadly, there doesn't seem to be a four-player co-op. Dun-dun-dun.
This is Gears of War 4
with no four-player co-op, unless they still introduce a horde mode, because they have put up on their Twitter page that they've got a major announcement in the next 3 days, but speculation is that the announcement's going to be like the special edition contents and potentially a limited edition Xbox One, because you know how obviously Gears like to do A lovely, nice, shiny Gears of War limited edition machine.
And give me like a flaming Lancer with it.
Yeah, an actual full blown Lancer that actually works. Could you imagine that? Mm-hmm. So I'm hoping that the announcement's going to contain some at least 4-player co-op in there. But the sad thing is, it's the fact that it's only the campaign's based around 3 characters. So have they ruled out the 4-player co-op thing straight away?
Right, I was going to say.
Who are the 3 characters?
I was going to say. I have an idea of a story.
The general consensus of the game is it takes place after a few years of the ending of 3.
Right.
And it stars Marcus Fenix, obviously the main character from. Mm-hmm. So I think everyone knows who Marcus Fenix is. So it's Marcus's son and his 2 friends. So Marcus isn't really involved in the story. I don't know if obviously he's involved in the story at some point, but the general consensus of the game is it's Marcus's son and his 2 friends that are the main heroes, if you like, in the
game. Guarantee you one of them's Carmine.
And this one's all about how they go outside the city. You know how obviously in the other Gears games you're quite contained where you are. Mm-hmm. This one seems to be a bit more sort of out there and how they go out exploring the walls outside the city. So that'll be pretty interesting. Mm-hmm. And they have turned around and said that it's going to run at 1080p and 30 frames per second in the campaign and a solid 60 in the multiplayer.
When we were talking about this before, you had a bit of an issue, not an issue, but you were wondering why they worded the way they did.
Yeah, I mean, it's strange because quote for quote what they've said is during the campaign it's going to run at 1080p and a solid 30 frames per second, but they've used the word solid there, and then on the multiplayer they've said that it's going to run at 1080p and a smooth 60 frames per second. So I'm a bit confused as to why they've chosen those two words there to describe obviously how the frames per second is going to run. Which makes me think it's a wee bit of kind of ambiguity, sort of something going on there in the background. But we'll wait and see. As I said, obviously it's just announcements at this stage, so we'll wait for the next 3 days and see what happens.
That'll be weird going from multiplayer to single player again, because like, have you ever played 60fps game and then went back to 30.
And back to how weird is it to quickly change between the two?
See, when I was playing, I played an absolute ton of Halo 5 when it came out first, a lot of the multiplayer, and then went back to Destiny, and I was just and it makes you feel kind of it makes your head feel kind of funny.
Yeah, a wee bit nauseating. Yeah, what am I doing? Yeah,
it's not right.
Yeah,
I'm trying to think of the last game I played in split screen. Lego maybe. But that wasn't all Lego, only if you went too far, didn't it?
If you went too far away from one another, the screen. Yeah, but that was like a dynamic split screen, that just wasn't half and half. That was like the whole screen like rotated and stuff like that. That was a different take, but I can't remember the last split screen game I properly
remember
played.
Remember exactly which one I played? It was Goat Simulator.
Are you kidding me on?
Goat Simulator on the PS4. Split screen.
Kidding me on, did you mean that?
Gidgin. Yes, kidding me on.
Shocking. I just clicked.
How was the splitting in Goat Simulator? I don't understand.
You just split it and then you're 2 goats. You get your pal as a goat and you as a goat and you go goating together.
You go goating together.
Yeah. Go karting.
Well, you can actually go bikes as a goat.
Really?
Yeah, you can also have a jetpack as a goat. You can lick cars and drag them around as a goat.
What, does your tongue stick to the car? And
I'll show you at some point. This game is absolutely mental, right?
Yeah, this is random.
It's a bit like, see if you imagine playing Tony Hawk's Pro Skater, like a really old one, as a goat.
As a simulator game, it doesn't sound that accurate, if I'm honest.
It's completely not.
No, I was going
to
say.
I think it's quite ironic. Well, they're trying to be ironic. There's also a demon goat.
Do you monitor goats 24 hours a day?
No, I suppose.
How do you know what they do?
I'd imagine if they were pulling cars with the tongues, I'd probably have seen that. You know, I've been in buses past fields. You know what I mean? I'd imagine I'd have seen that at some stage.
Quick, hide, they're coming. It's like Toy Story. It's like when Andy's coming, they all just drop to the floor.
Yeah, that's it. That's it. Yeah.
It seems to be a week of announcements. Back on topic.
Yeah.
A week of announcements, folks, isn't it, really, to be honest?
Mm-hmm. Quite a lot.
Mm-hmm. There's quite a few this week.
Next one we have here is the Naughty Dog one.
There can only be one of 2 topics. Either one's Uncharted or 2 is, dare we say it, Crash Bandicoot. So which one are we talking?
It could be both. It is both.
Announcements for both.
The announcement for Crash Bandicoot. It was more of a teaser announcement. Really, was it?
I don't even know where it came from. Did it come from Naughty Dog? It just appeared.
It appeared on social media and just went warm. Just went total viral.
Yeah, it was everywhere. It was that image. I don't know if you guys saw it. I'm sure we'll manage to tweet it somehow. But it was that picture. And it was like silhouette of Crash,
and the kind of sunset, and it was like 2016 Hero Returns, and everyone was like, oh my god.
And the wee Bagoom guy was there, wasn't he?
Yeah,
and the wee background as well.
Yeah. It puts more credence to the fact that they've changed their profile picture on PSN. I say
it
this every
does.
Week. I say this every week.
Yes, yes. They did change their PSN profile picture that one time in that podcast long ago.
Yeah. Yes, but from Uncharted's Nathan Drake to Crash Bandicoot. And
topic. I'm telling you, that's coming at E3. Stay tuned. That's definitely getting unveiled at E3.
So what are we doing for E3? We'll talk about that off air. We're going to do something special.
Live streams and everything.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Red Bull.
Don't tease me now.
Yeah, do it live.
Then it goes on Red Bull.
I can live with that.
Oh, it's on there. You've put it out there now.
Yeah, I think so. We've got it. The other thing from Naughty Dog this week was that this... can I say this? Is it a spoiler? No, they've said it.
Yeah, we can just rehash what they're saying.
It doesn't allude anything to the fate of the character in question.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, we don't know if he's going to wind up with no legs dead or
Naughty Dog have said that this is going to be the last Uncharted starring Nathan Drake, and we kind of knew that this was going to be the last one per se, but well, I'm trying to think, it's kind of flipped it a little bit. I thought this was going to be the last Uncharted,
yeah,
but now they're saying
I thought this is now
it's the last Uncharted with Nathan Drake.
Either can I put that little spin on it, which makes you think, could there be like a spin off with another character or new story?
That for me, like bringing it in with like another character or whatever, just brings me back to like that question that you had a couple of weeks ago that was like, is it fan service or is it
just a
money making device? Mm-hmm. And it's like, well, I feel like after the fourth game, unless you're changing to a different developer or there's reason for it to continue, you're kind of ripping that a wee bit.
Well, that's the thing, because not only have they teased the fact that they've said that it's going to be the last Uncharted without. With Nathan Drake, sorry. So the next Uncharted per se isn't going to have Nathan Drake in it. Mm-hmm. But what they've also turned around and said is that they're open to the idea of another studio picking up the franchise.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
So effectively, they're quite happy to hand over the reins of the Uncharted title and everything that goes with it to another studio, pending that the studio that's taken on understands and is able to capture the essence of the whole Uncharted franchise, which is incredibly interesting.
The only studio, like I said this earlier, the only studio that I can think of that would be doing that were the guys that did Golden Abyss for the Vita. It was Ready at Dawn, who also did the other.
Yes, yeah. That's true. Mm-hmm. I think there should be a lot of this stuff going on where franchises, if you like, gaming franchises, are not passed around, but more so that for Konami, right? What are they going to do with the next Metal Gear? If there's going to be a next Metal Gear. Do you know what I mean? Yeah, exactly.
I don't know, we're going to have like the...
Exactly.
The Grey Mist just descended there into like the whole different realm and dimension stuff.
Yeah,
like that.
So...
It's not even worth thinking about, to be fair.
Surely, if they're not going to do the next Metal Gear justice, why not pump it out to somebody?
Get someone else to do it, yeah. Like, there are so many like talented game developers and whatnot out there now. Like, you see it even... like guys that aren't working for big studios or whatever, you see people making like kind of smaller games or projects where they'll put games into new engines and stuff, and it's just crazy like how good things look.
Speaking of new engines and stuff, did you see like recently they put up like, you know how ages ago we seen what Spyro would look like in the Unreal Engine and stuff like that. And more recently they just uploaded one that's got Mario in it as well. They put Mario in Unreal Engine. It's absolutely crazy what these games could potentially look like, obviously, if they're picked up and stuff like that.
The one that always kind of blew my mind the most was the BioShock one, like the original BioShock.
Yeah,
guy had done it, and that was the kind of like the first one of those things that I'd seen with people like updating graphics on old games.
Yeah.
And it looked absolutely amazing.
No, it did look good.
Really hope they do that remaster that everyone was talking about.
That'd be good.
Another thing that's been announced this week, Craig, you know a little bit more than about you. Well, you've shown us a video earlier on. Was the God of War?
Yeah, like. Can neither confirm nor deny whether it's sort of in existence or not, if that makes any sense.
Yeah.
There's been some leaked images, and Sony's yet to confirm or deny whether they're in existence or not, but they're obviously there for people to view, and whether it relates to God of War 4 sort of remains to be seen as such. But it's got images of Kratos sporting a lovely new beard. Which is strange for the franchise, but obviously we all have to age at some point.
Mm-hmm.
So he's got a shiny new beard, and it's sort of going down the whole Norse mythology route in this one. So it's got images of like Valhalla portrayals and the pantheon of Norse gods and stuff like that. So that could be incredibly interesting if that's the route that the next God of War's going down. Mm-hmm. But as I said, it's only like images that's been leaked, and no one's confirmed or denied whether they're actual proper in existence or not. So yeah. It's very interesting.
God of War is it's one of these games. I'm trying to think how to describe it. It's weird. I think it sells really well, God of War. Well, it does sell really well.
Yeah, yeah.
But it doesn't have that clamour. It doesn't have the Fallout clamour.
You mean like the big AAA title?
Yeah.
I
think it's viewed as a AAA title, and it sells like a AAA title, but I don't think it's got the fever of a AAA title.
Yeah.
Especially for something that's been going as long.
For me, I think God of War, I was always just like that. Oh, Kratos. Really cool. And then Ascension is the only one that I've actually played any of. And I remember playing it like in one of the shops at a kind of early preview thingy that we had. Mm-hmm. And it was really, really cool. I thoroughly enjoyed playing it there. But still, I haven't picked up any of them yet. And I think with God of War 4, and if they're taking this kind of new direction with it and going towards Norse mythology and having this character there, then it could be really cool, yeah?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Sounds good.
So once again, we'll see if we can get a couple of those pictures as well.
That'd be a good shout. We'll get a hold of a few of the pictures.
We'll get them out there as well.
Yeah.
So people can make up their own minds. Because once again, this is rumour mill-esque stuff.
Yeah,
nothing's been confirmed, or as you said, confirmed or denied. So it'd be good to see people's ideas of what's...
Yeah.
What you all think.
Yeah. The next thing we have here is a Doom beta.
I like that whole wee sound that you did. It was like a whoa, whoa, whoa,
whoa, whoa, whoa, whoa.
I was just like a character, and I can't remember what it sounded like there.
Trying to see if the mic picked it up, and unfortunately did. the Doom beta, do you guys get a chance?
Yeah. The closed beta obviously took place sort of last week-esque, and obviously the open beta, just obviously for everyone who hasn't had a chance to pick it up yet,
next week
starts on the 15th. Cool. Yeah, so hashtag 15th in your calendar.
Mm-hmm.
Unless you're playing Dark Souls.
Well, there is that, yeah. But I think once you put the Doom beta on, even just to try it,
you're going to be
playing Doom.
Dark Souls will still be there afterwards.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. The good thing is that they've already confirmed 3 paid DLC packs for Doom after release, so they know where they want to go with the game even before obviously it's out in May, so they know what they want to do with it.
Mm-hmm.
For anyone that's played the Doom beta, let us know what you think, like we said before, but there's an incredible amount of huge comparisons being made to going back to the whole Unreal Tournament era, so like that's quite a big oh my god statement to make, but honestly the game is tremendous. It strips away everything that... This is going to sound so opposite of what I'm enjoying at the moment. But obviously in Destiny, you've got your XP and your light levels and things like that. You still get XP in the beta, but it sort of strips it all out. And it's just a case of, oh my God, there's one huge ass monster in front of you. Everybody shoot it. Everybody just stop what they're doing and shoot that monster. It's just all about gameplay. It's really, really good.
It sounds pretty fun. It sounds like one that you can probably just pick up and play. Like, at your leisure. You don't have to invest a lot of time. You can just get on and kill some monsters.
Yeah.
Like, I think it's one that I'll end up picking up. Maybe not on launch, but I will pick it up just because it looks like fun.
I think the good thing with Doom is, like, it's what I hate about COD. Is the thing for me is if I don't pick up COD on day of launch, I know if I pick it up a week later, I'm going to suck at the game for about 3 months because everyone's had that chance to...
Yeah, everyone's had that chance to kind of like invest themselves into the learning curve and learn what's different about this COD, what makes it this one.
Yeah,
Whereas
when I picked up the Doom beta COD, put it in, redeemed my COD, I was maybe about 2 days late, and I was like, oh, I'm just going to try it and see what it's like. But straight away, like the pick up and play aspect is there.
Yeah.
The whole... Like, I totally sensed the whole Unreal Tournament vibe from it. It took me back to early PC and...
I was going to say, Unreal Tournament, that's a bit of a statement, isn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, especially in first-person shooter teams.
Yeah.
Nowadays as well, but even going back to... When you talk about first-person, there's obviously... There's the staple of COD or Battlefield per se, but to turn around and say Unreal Tournament-esque, because even GoldenEye as well, which...
Oh no, I can't speak of that yet. Spoiler.
But if it does anything like Unreal Tournament does, I think it's going
to
be cracking. Really?
I was talking to Billy earlier. Obviously, for those of you know, those guys, Billy works at the office and stuff. Mm-hmm. So we're talking to Billy, and he's been playing the Doom beta as well. And he gave me a full insight to the whole King of the Hill idea. I haven't played the King of the Hill game modes yet. But he was saying that obviously in your traditional games like your Halos and stuff, where you've got like your controller, your King of the Hill, it's in a static position like, on the map. So like as soon as you know what map you're going to, you know where the King of the Hill as such is going
to be. Where you need to be.
So you know it's just going to be massacre at that one point all the time. Mm-hmm. But in Doom, it moves like on a conveyor belt, so it's constantly moving. So even though you get the one point, it's like moving around the map as you're playing, so like it it's never in the same point.
It keeps the gameplay kind of interesting. It will reduce the kind of, like, if that game mode does become popular, it means that people aren't going to camp and, you know, all
exactly.
these kind of staples that people have come to hate about multiplayer shooters.
I think
that sounds really interesting.
Yeah, I think it's just going to be that shooter that everybody's been wanting to play for a good number of years, and definitely. So,
like I say, it just sounds like good fun.
Yeah, things are looking good, so definitely for Doom.
I hinted at it. I said it.
You put it out there and...
Chris Rock.
No,
I said it.
No one was ready.
I know. I know.
Ahead of your time.
I know. And it kills me a little bit to say it as well, but it's Microsoft. They've got the license for GoldenEye.
Yeah!
Mm-hmm.
Can you imagine what that title's going to look like? Well, now this is the age-old debate. They have said that they have acquired the full license, so this will kind of coincide with the whole Rare Replay idea that they had, because obviously remember when they released Rare Replay, everyone was like, oh, that means you've got GoldenEye, and that was like the only big title that everyone was looking for.
It wasn't on it.
So Microsoft were saying at the time they were working on it, they've now got it, and they've now released that, similar to obviously what they've done with Killer Instinct and stuff.
It
is going to be an Xbox exclusive, but they're planning to do what they're calling a remake. Now, does that mean a full-blown remake or a remaster? Now, those two terms are quite different.
We'll see. It depends. Like, I think with games that are considered by many to be like the games that changed. Like the way that we play games and the way that things are kind of perceived and whatnot. That's one of the ones that a lot of people will be like, "Don't touch it. Don't touch it."
Just give us. Just give us as is.
Which really kind of throws me off about remaster and stuff, because I want something fresh and something new, something exciting, something 2016, not like really old game. But it's just when they do it with games that, as I say, are considered to be so like revolutionary, like it's just like, what can you change? Like, how can you make it have the same effect now that it had 20 odd years ago?
Well, I think GoldenEye was the first four-player co-op shooter that I played, like, ever. So for me, I'd love them just to keep game as is, but give me a refresh on the graphics. So just touch the graphics,
make it look better.
Don't touch maps, don't do anything at all to the game other than give me a refresh on 1080p visuals, please. Thanks very much, and I'll gladly pay for that.
I think if they manage to do a GoldenEye remake and do it right and do it really well, it could be absolutely huge for kind of Microsoft's corner.
I think that's quite a big coup for that. I think that, because I think Microsoft is counting this as one of their big E3 post announcements sort of thing. You know how obviously Sony and Microsoft like to go to war for pre announcements for E3 and stuff. This was Microsoft's first sort of swing for a home run sort of thing. I think they've got it with that one. So it'll be interesting to see what Sony comes back with. Obviously, they've got the whole, they got Crash in their corner and wee bit of God of War 4 to retaliate with, so it'll be interesting. But that one goes to Microsoft for me, so hats off.
The question here is the remake or remaster one, isn't it? Because, I mean, in a music sense, you could remake a song and it could sound completely different to what it's supposedly covering, but a remaster is essentially turning it up. You know what I mean? You know, it's just making it a little bit more crisper, a little bit more... a little bit more relevant, and that could, like, I don't want to say it could make or break it, but if they tried to remake GoldenEye and got it wrong, not only they screwed themselves now, they're screwing the memory. You know?
Yeah, it's like that, it's like Final Fantasy VII as well.
Yeah.
Like, because with this remake coming out, and it's so divisive, like, you see there are people that are so supportive of it and are like, do it, it's going to be absolutely amazing, and then you have the other side where people are like, no, this is the game that I played.
Yeah.
Like, I invested so much time into, you have to leave it the way it is. You can't
take away turn-based combat or anything, because that's, you're ruining it.
Yeah.
And it's just, it is really divisive, but I think it's, I don't know, it's interesting, and I'm interested to see where they go with it.
All right, we'll put it out there. What do you want? Do you want a remake? Do you want a remaster? You know, tell us. Get on to us on Facebook and Twitter. Let us know. What do you want? Do you want a remake of games, or do you want it to remaster? Do you want to keep what they've done already and polish it up? Or do you want them to take what they've done and rebuild it, step on the shoulders of what they've done? Or do you want a remake or a remaster? Let us know.
Or the third option, new games.
Oh yeah, there is that as well. Like, you know, they can make new stuff.
Hashtag new game.
Yeah. there is that. Also as well, leaving the Xbox for it and going on to the PS4. New update this week, 3.5.
Yeah, Kieran, you've got some news on that.
Yeah, it's actually really interesting and pretty cool. It allows remote play from PC and Mac via, well, basically all that happens is it streams the signal from your PS4 straight to whichever device you'd want it on.
Kind of like the Play TV type idea, isn't it?
Oh, yeah, so it's like, TV. Like, there are ways to do it. Like, there's an app that you can download just called Remote Play. I've got it on my phone and my Nexus 7 tablet in the house already. And basically, I can just sit in bed and have the display from the PS4 on the Nexus 7 and just sit there and have my controller and just play it. Like,
that's pretty sweet, isn't
it? Really? I was gonna say,
it is pretty cool.
I was going to say, I seen some guy doing it in his bath, but like, that whole context just sounded like way left field. Yeah. So I seen a guy post a video on Facebook who'd done it through the streaming service when he was in a bath.
Yeah, no, I've seen that.
So I was just clarifying there. That wasn't as creepy as what it sounded.
That's all right, man. You know, it's what you're doing your own time's fine. Next one, a video came out today. Was it today?
Yeah, it was.
Trailer came out today.
And this kind of leads on to a question we've got later on. But the Star Wars Rogue One, I haven't seen it yet.
It's awesome. Talk to me.
Basically, it's a spin off coming away from episode 7 to episode 8.
Right. Well, it focuses on the time way before, like when they were still in the Death Star plans.
Yeah, so it's like going way back. So this is what, like, Disney's whole franchise idea, where they want to rebuild like the gaps in the story almost.
Right.
So like episode 4, they talk about obviously stealing the plans for the Death Star and stuff like that, but the story never really elaborates on that. Well, Rogue One's going to elaborate on that, like, in a huge way. On you go, Kieran.
I just think it looks so cool. Like, see, having, like, the kind of the Empire back.
Yeah.
And just, like, as kind of, like, you see the kind of higher-ups and whatnot. I don't know who the particular, like, general or whatever it was that was there. I don't know if it's, like, Grand Moff Tarkin or whoever. I know he's, like, one of the big names. But it looks so amazing to have, like, the Empire back, and you realise that they are scary.
Yeah.
Again, like,
you get that whole chill factor in the trailer. And
aye,
that,
like,
So, because... No, I'm not going to say anything here, but because it's before episode 8, is it 8?
Yeah.
It's before...
It's before 4 and 5.
Right.
So it's before the original trilogy.
Right. So there could be people in this one that aren't in the later ones.
Technically, but there'll be a big time gap between, obviously, look at the time gap between 4 and 7 just now.
Yeah, I suppose.
And how, obviously, how much Luke has aged, technically.
Yeah, yeah.
So that person would have to technically age, but there'll be references to the characters in Rogue One, probably in episode 8,
So I was assuming this one was, like, the next one.
No. The format for this is basically what's going to happen is we're going to have Rogue One this year, episode 8 the year after. The year after that, they're scheduled for a Han Solo movie. Basically kind of chronicle his years before joining up with Luke and Leia and whatnot. And
Has he been cast?
No, Solo? But the only person that I can see doing him is Oscar Isaac, who we can't have because he's Poe Dameron. I would have been rooting for him to be.
There's been a few high A celeb actors that's went for screen tests and stuff. But nothing's been confirmed as to who'll play young Han. That sounds weird, young Han, do you know what I mean?
Who's been?
I can't even remember who. I just put that out there. But there has been two or three that has openly said I have went for casting for the role, but no one's actually said obviously I've got it or he's got it.
I'm anxious about that.
in the trailer for Rogue One, though, you do see like you see the finishing of the Death Star, so you see like that, you see that getting finished off, like the actual plate getting getting put on it and stuff. Just it just gives you that whole, well, for me, it gives me that whole original trilogy feel.
It's
special feel back in Star Wars.
Aye, it's like a nostalgia, like back to like when I was a wee guy watching A New Hope and my aunties.
Yeah.
12-inch TV or whatever it was.
And then the whole lead character. I think Disney's just in and tangent, we're obviously doing female leads just now, which leads on to our conversation last week about obviously females being portrayed and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So the lead character for Rogue One is again another female, and she looks badass.
Yeah, she's
looks incredible.
Aye, like you see a lot of those clips and stuff of her just like absolutely like battering stormtroopers.
Aye, slaying stormtroopers and everything. Looks incredible.
Ah,
there you go.
Looks brilliant.
We'll put a link of the trailer on there. Yep. On the podcast link and stuff like that as
good
well.
Good to see Disney listen to us. That's what we like to hear.
Of course they do.
Also, as well, on that conversation last week, Overwatch.
Yeah, they brought the character back.
Yeah,
that one that they chucked out.
Yeah, well, the character never went. The pose they changed. They changed the pose, but then replaced the pose with another ass pose. I'm allowed to say ass, aren't I? Yeah.
Science, as you can say, what you want.
Yeah. Ass.
Yes, I'll say it.
Changed to another
ass. There you go.
Rear end pose.
Sorry, mum.
So.
Sorry, mum. Yeah, she's not listening. Let's face it.
She does.
Really?
Yeah.
She's your family listening?
No, my family. Don't think my family listens. No.
No, I said I don't.
I'm going to get him to listen now, though.
Yeah. No,
I feel left out now.
No, I'm not going
to. Let's do a shout out for Mrs. Gillen.
Yeah, hello, Mrs. Gillen. Hello, Kieran's mum. How are you?
That's nice. That's like when you were seven.
Hey, hi, Kieran. hello, Kieran's mum. Yeah.
Where were we? Yeah. Sorry, you think things. Yeah. Other things.
Say hello to Kieran's
mum.
Tick. Yeah. There we go.
Brownie points.
Yes.
We did speak about the whole crash thing. Sorry, I was going to talk about what happened on Sunday night there. Things that have passed. The largest sporting event outside of the Super Bowl. As far as I'm aware, yes.
Liverpool Tottenham. We got a point. We got a point. Yes.
Talking about WrestleMania 32. I think the whole thing this year lasted about 5.5, close to 6 hours this year. 101,000 people attended in the stadium.
Really?
Yeah. See, how surprised are you at that?
Nice.
Bet you didn't even think there'd be half of that.
I didn't. Yeah, I didn't.
It's the biggest grossing event in sports entertainment apart from the Super Bowl.
Really?
Yeah, Super Bowl's number one, WrestleMania's always number two. True story.
I suppose that wouldn't surprise me, but I wouldn't have said it was that amount of folk. That's crazy.
Yeah. I guess like if you're a wrestling fan, you're a wrestling fan. If you're not, then you could watch it for the
never took an interest in it.
The sporting entertainment. What it was particularly good this year, you'd a whole load of Hall of Famers back in it. Stone Cold. Like, people always know the trademark names, Stone Cold, Shawn Michaels, Mick Foley. They were all back. The Rock was back. John Cena made his welcome back from his injury and stuff like that as well.
Just taking time off of being an internet meme.
Yeah.
Do some wrestling.
Wrestling, I've always it's up there with World of Warcraft for me.
What?
Well, you either play it or you don't.
Yeah, well, exactly. It's one of these things that I know if I got into it, I'd lose days over it. You know what I mean? I think it's one of these ones. Once it grabs you, it doesn't let you go. And I think World of Warcraft as well. I mean, obviously, World of Warcraft. You know, there's people like sitting there and. Huge adult nappies and stuff. I don't think it's people doing that in the wrestling.
You just put that image in my head. Don't do that again.
Just an image, you know?
Yeah. Just in the nappy.
I think the big thing to come out for WrestleMania was Shane McMahon, who's Vince's son. So Vince McMahon owns basically WWE.
Yeah, because isn't he married to somebody?
Who? Vince?
Yeah.
I couldn't tell you who's married to. Well, he's
I thought he was. Isn't there somebody married to, like, the owner?
Well, Triple H is married to Stephanie.
Oh, that's sorry. See, I'm just getting confused. Sorry.
But Vince McMahon's son Shane, who's not been in the WWE business for I'm going maybe back 5-10 years ago now. He was away off in Japan. He owns basically like a broadcasting company in Japan, but he came back for WrestleMania to try and take back the legacy of WWE, like obviously this whole storyline spin, and he was to fight The Undertaker in a Hell in a Cell match. And obviously, if people don't know what Hell in a Cell is, it's like a 35-40 foot structure that surrounds the ring, basically. Remember an old fashioned steel cage match?
This one's
got like a roof on it, and obviously the Shane McMahon climbed to the top of the roof on the cell and tried to do like a flying elbow to The Undertaker, who was on a table, but The Undertaker moved, so he basically jumped 40 foot to the ground and stuff like that. So that was the big talking point from WrestleMania.
That's not a smart move.
He is fine. He did go to hospital and he appeared on TV the night after. So yeah, he is fine. He's battered and bruised, but no, like one hell of a move to do live on TV where anything can go wrong. So
I was listening to a thing the other day talking about The Undertaker, and I didn't realise how old he was.
Seriously?
Yeah, so, but see, when you think about it, I mean, he's been there forever.
Yeah,
but I mean, he's never come out of like character, I suppose. I mean,
no, he's always like he's probably the one character in WWE who hasn't changed a persona. Well, he changed a persona from The Undertaker to American Badass for like a period of like 2 or 3 years,
right.
Where he just became like an American biker, pretty much. So he changed his persona then, but he's never really came away from like the Phenom, undead guy who just. Doesn't feel pain and stuff.
Well, there's that music as well when that starts playing.
Yeah,
like,
that's
the place goes mental.
That's
it?
All goosebump time. Yeah. That's on my bucket list. I'm definitely wanting to go to a WrestleMania before I'm too old to go and enjoy it. Definitely.
Yeah, I think he would be too old. I mean, if he's doing it now, what's he? 50s or something?
Aye, and then some.
Like, is he older than that?
Yeah, he's older. Yeah.
I thought he was. I don't know.
I was just going to IMDb him there.
Yeah.
How old Undertaker is?
Yeah.
But yeah, sorry. Anyway, yeah. Where does that take us to now?
It's pretty much it. We've ran out of it.
Is that this week?
Yeah. There was a question actually. I was speaking to Kevin McFarlane, and he was talking about spoilers, and it was kind of about when I said the question about the Star Wars, it was to do with that. What's your thoughts on spoilers? Why do we need to see spoilers? Why are spoilers a thing? Why are spoilers a thing? There's two ways you can look at this. Obviously, I think there's two branches of spoilers. The spoilers of argument's sake. I've like.
Good point.
Thank you. If you got Benedict Cumberbatch, right, playing Doctor Strange, right, he's walking about in his costume,
yeah,
right, or actually, the main movie in my head is when The Dark Knight Rises, and you had pictures of Tom Hardy, and you had as Bane, and you had pictures of Batman having a Barney in the street, right. And that's while it's getting made and that's getting put out there like years before we see it.
Yeah.
Why?
Because we...
I know that.
That kind of thing's fine. Like, I don't think that's an issue. I think what is an issue is like major plot points.
Well, see, that's what I was going to say. That's my second part of spoilers. Spoilers with regards to... Spoilers... I've got 2 points. The first point is spoilers with regards to the production of it. And spoilers with regards to social media. For example, did you see that Walking Dead last night where such and such got his face bitten off? I've done watch Walking Dead, so...
I'd bite someone for doing that. Well, I hate people who do that.
I remember when Star Wars came out, and on... I don't know if either of you guys use Reddit, but I use Reddit all the time. Like, I'm never off it. But you couldn't go anywhere without there being Star Wars spoilers in comment sections. You would comment... saying nasty things about people that were ruining Star Wars. You would get a private message telling you what happened in Star Wars, and it was just it's brutal. Like, there were particular forums and whatnot, you'd go on and there would just be like spoilers everywhere. Like, that one major point, like, I don't want to ruin it, I know it's been out for like 6 months, but I still don't want to ruin it for anybody out there that's not seen The Force Awakens yet. But there's one major thing.
I've not seen it.
You've not?
No, I know what it is. I know what it is because it was spoiled. But I know. Yeah.
And that probably deterred you from going to see it because you already know.
It's exactly, that's exactly why I haven't.
Yeah, I don't like Star Wars.
You even coughed at that there to try and disguise the fact that you actually just put out on air that you don't like Star Wars.
Well, it's not that I don't like it. I like the story.
Hey,
I think boys,
cut out when you do this again.
Yeah. Michael can't be here this week. He's fell down the stairs.
Do you like Star Trek? Nah, see, the whole thing is usually like if you don't like Star Wars, you love Star Trek.
Neither. No, see, like I say, I like the idea of Star Wars. I think the story. I think I'm can't believe I'm gonna say this, but if it was a book, right, I think it'd be really good. I like the story.
Well, there is a book you can get called Eragon.
Really?
Isn't that the one about the dragons? But see, if you read it and then you look at Star Wars, it's Star Wars with dragons.
Yeah.
Alright, so it's not Star Wars though.
No, but it's essentially
right.
It's the same story.
Star Wars and Dragons.
Right.
That was my dragon impression.
That was really good. That surprised me.
I didn't know any fire though.
So, like I say, I like the idea of Star Wars. I like the story, and I think it's a very good story. But I just don't think it's done well. I just don't think it seems too kiddie. I don't know. And the looks I'm getting, Christ. Moving on. Spoilers and that.
Jeez,
I know. Right. Spoilers on social media. There shouldn't be a thing.
See, for me, if we're talking about it in social media, no, there shouldn't be a thing, and I think there should be like a filter system. Where as soon as you mention like some set of keywords, then that post automatically gets removed. For example,
well, I have a good relevant one. Right, this is about Dark Souls, obviously.
Right,
but like I got really, really annoyed the other day because I went on YouTube, like going through my recommended videos and whatnot. So IGN had posted a video. And it was the first boss fight, right? I was like, right, cool, first boss fight, don't need to watch it. But the title of the video was the first boss's name. And I'm just like...
So even though you don't want to see them, you subsequently still see them, sort of thing?
Yeah, it's like, it's like, especially when it's something, like, I've been hiding from information for so long. And you just go on, and it's just...
It's there.
It's just there in front of you, and there's no way to avoid it or anything. It's just kind of like, well... cheers, guys.
It's there.
Well, like, see, DVDs annoy me. Well, maybe not DVDs, but like Blu-rays as well. See, when you're watching a movie and it's a menu screen, you've got play, and you've got scenes, and you've got options, you've got subtitles, and then actually playing the movie.
Yeah.
That does my head in.
Yeah, that's quite annoying.
That, because I can't get that. I don't understand why they're doing that.
Yeah. The only thing that bugs me about spoilers. In effect, as when I'm such a big trailer fan, like I'd watch trailers for films and stuff all day long. Like I go to the cinema and see if like we're late for the trailers. I don't want to see the movie because we've missed the trailers. I'll go to see the movie, but I love going to see trailers.
Yeah.
And if I watch a trailer and there's like a whole plot twist or something that's played out in that trailer, I'm like, why would you do that?
Exactly.
I understand that you want to get people to go and see your movie and stuff, but don't give me stuff like that in the trailer. My prime example was Terminator, the new one.
Genesis, the bad one.
Yeah. So Terminator Genesis, the trailer came up. First couple of trailers was fine because it didn't really reveal anything. And then as time went on, they revealed more and more and more. And then the whole thing with John Connor, like they actually put that in the trailer, and I'm like, why on earth would you do that? Because that's one of your biggest twists, like, throughout that whole franchise. That's going to be your biggest twist in that movie, and you've just ruined it for everybody because you've put it in the trailer. Now I don't want to go and see the movie. And guess what? I haven't.
Well, see, there's so many branches to this, because it doesn't even have to be a spoiler. It doesn't even have to be... my example for this is the Red Wedding in Game of Thrones, right?
That's a big one.
But I never saw it live. I didn't see it the day after. But... everyone was talking about, oh my god, there's a huge break of a thing in Game of Thrones at the end. And by the time I was getting to it, I was like, by the time I got sat down to watch it, I knew that there was a huge thing coming at the end. I didn't know the spoiler. I didn't know what happened at all. But because of people's reactions, oh my god, that was such a twist. I didn't see that coming.
But that's the age that we live in now, though. Yeah. We live on... society lives in social media, so you know if you don't watch it as it's out, you're going to get something.
Even AMC did it with a Walking Dead. See, because it was shown in America like the day before.
Yeah,
they put up on social media, oh, what did you think when blah 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 happened? Yeah. I was like, well, it hasn't even been shown here yet.
It's quite ignorant sometimes, I think. Yeah. And I think there should be like a full filter system. See if you could go onto Facebook or Twitter and just type in things you don't want to see. If you could, I think that would be awesome. If I could go onto Facebook and type in, I don't want to see spoilers from Bates Motel. So if I just typed in Bates Motel, then my newsfeed wouldn't have anything to do with Bates Motel, and I think that would be quite a good idea.
Interestingly enough, there is a Chrome plugin you can get called, I think, a spoiler blackout, something along those lines. And you can actually type in words that you would like to be filtered out.
Right, okay.
And words kind of pertaining to. Well, being relevant to what you mean, so it'll basically just blur them out, which is cool. But at the same time, why should you have to go and get a set?
You shouldn't have to go and do something.
So spoilers, Jim, put them in the bin. There's no point.
Get rid of that.
What about like with regards to productions? Like say the Batman.
I think that's fine because see if you say, oh, Bane's in this film. Evidently, Batman and Bane are going to be fighting at some point.
I know.
What you've got to remember is, see, like, revealing the whole Benedict Cumberbatch's Doctor Strange, like an image of him walking. I mean, he was in that comic book store, just like browsing around as dressed as Doctor Strange. That builds hype for the movie. They rely on things like that for.
But for example, Kit Harington, the guy who plays Jon Snow. Well, he is in the last series. He snuffed it. You know what I mean? He was like made a pin cushion. Mm-hmm. He was stabbing him in there. If he's we don't, by rights, he shouldn't be in this one.
Mm-hmm.
But by, you know, through spoilers of people saying, oh, he was in this such and such location when...
The thing with Game of Thrones is, though, like, she just, like, the amount of, like, have you read the books?
No.
See, just the amount of, like, see if you go on, like, there's Reddit forums and stuff of people talking about the books, and honestly, the level of, like, depth and detail that people have went to with studying these books
is absolutely
insane.
I mean, I've seen a few
and,
videos,
like, all the kind of foreshadowing and whatnot and things that pertain to John's supposed resurrection and whatnot. Mm-hmm. Well, do you think he's going to come back?
Well, Ian McShane is in it, and he said he's going to be in it because of the... What do you call it?
This is again with spoilers.
Direction of a character.
Spoilers with Game of Thrones is an issue that I'm having just now because I'm actually not going to watch this season.
Why?
Because it's ahead of the book.
So you're the other way.
I want to read it rather
before you see it.
Because I don't like essential battles, but I prefer the books to the show, just because I feel like if you're reading the book, you get so much more from it. Like,
isn't that the case with everything, though?
It is, but at the same time, I would rather, like, see, it's just the fact that it's ahead of it. Like, I don't want to know, like, because obviously it's inaccurate to it.
Yeah.
But it's not completely accurate, and there are things that have happened in the book that haven't happened in the show, and there are things that happened in the show that haven't happened in the book yet. Like, the battle for Winterfell with Stannis and whatnot hasn't happened in the book yet. They're just kind of building up to that now. And it's just kind of like, well...
How are you going to avoid it?
See, this is what my issue is.
I don't see how you're going to avoid
it. See, the thing is, see, for me, right, I don't watch Game of Thrones, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, see if I see... I can go through my Facebook feed and not pay any attention to Game of Thrones. Mm-hmm. So if I'm not watching it, I can stay away from it. And that's kind of programmed in you that if you're not interested in it, you don't look at it, so you just scroll past it. Mm-hmm. Whereas because you're interested in Game of Thrones, you still don't want to see the spoilers, but as soon as you see Game of Thrones on your Facebook or your Twitter feed, you automatically go,
fact as well, like, the thing that bothers me so much about the show is the fact that you don't have, like, there's so many, really interesting characters in the book that we haven't seen yet in the show, like the Greyjoys. There are a lot more of them that have to come into it.
Nice.
And even, like, see, even in the last season where you had... the people from Dorne, those characters there, like, there's a kind of more of them and stuff, and more to their story that's supposed to come into it, and Aerys Volcar and stuff.
The Viper, he was from Dorne, wasn't he?
Yes, he was.
Yeah. See the bit with him? No, he didn't. Spoiler.
Yeah,
he did. But see that bit? Oh, it was crazy. But once again, that happened with me. Actually, it didn't happen with me, but I was in the room when it did happen. Someone had seen that episode at the time
with the mountain fighting against the mountain. He's
massive, isn't he?
He's in real life.
Oh, I was gonna say, if you see a picture of him from like 21 to 26,
it's crazy.
It's absolutely like me and then Bart.
It's
bonkers. It's amazing. But once again, there's just after that episode was aired, somebody said, "Oh, I can't believe such and such has just happened." So what?
Yeah, why have you done this?
What? So how long do you leave social media for if you don't want to see something?
No, that's true.
That was awesome. The Red Viper was awesome.
I think if you put it back into context, spoilers relating to TV and movies as they're being watched in live is wrong.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Totally wrong.
Mm-hmm.
But spoilers like movie trailers, and like when you're talking about Benedict Cumberbatch dressed as Doctor Strange.
Yeah, that probably wasn't good. I understand that.
But see things like that. That's good because that gets people talking about the general topic.
Yeah, definitely.
But so I'd still say it's a spoiler because you still get to see what the character and things are going to look like.
Yeah.
So I like that, but I don't like the whole I'm just going to spoil that full series or whatever for.
Well, like the thing I think I know which trailer you were talking about with Jon Snow, and is the one with the Hall of Faces, and you see all the faces. No.
So the only reason is because one of the actors who's in it, Ian McShane,
has said.
He said he hasn't mentioned Jon Snow, but he said he's in it, involving the resurrection of a main character.
All right. Okay. Cool.
So everyone's saying, "Oh, it's going to be Jon Snow."
Well, there was that whole thing, like they had that Hall of Faces trailer where they had like all the faces and the Hall of Faces, and then Jon's was shown like in between the characters who were living and dead, and I think that it's back to what Craig said about it building up like hype and stuff for the series, because no one knows whether or not Jon is dead or not, because as I say, this is where the books are as well.
Mm-hmm.
Like, nobody knows.
And as Ian McShane said, as well. He said it doesn't really matter, it's just tits and dragons. So so that's us coming to the end.
Big dragons.
Big dragons.
Woo!
And pointy dragons.
What?
Don't get it. Oh, that's been totally over your head, man.
There we go.
My mum's listening.
Yeah.
Sorry, Mrs. Kieran's mum.
Sorry, Mrs. Kieran's mum.
Sorry, Mrs. Kieran's mum.
Here we go again.
Yeah. Right, I've enjoyed that.
Yeah, it was good.
That was good fun.
Need to stay tuned for next week, folks, because next week's going to be really good because we're going to be talking. Destiny update is going to be live next week.
Yes.
Also got the Division cousins and excursions and stuff happening. Dark Souls 3 is obviously launched, so
if I'm not here, then don't be surprised.
Kieran might not be here, so there might be a Dark Souls 3 void, but I'm sure me and Michael will be able to fill it in. So we're going to be talking much more about updates and really good gameplay and stuff for next week, so make sure you tune in. But any questions and stuff, make sure you post them in.
Any questions, once again, you can post them to us individually. You can go into the stores, talk about it. Tweet us on at the GCPC.
The GCPC.
Oh, Charlie.
Yeah. Geocaching did us out of the GC pod.
Yeah.
Those rascals. thanks very much. I've been Michael.
I've been Kieran Yellen.
And I've been Batman.
I've been Batman.
Did you forget that I was Batman for that episode?
I did.
I'm still Batman.
Here we go. So, see you next week, guys.
Cheers, guys.
Bye bye.